from Kenya. They're very narrow. There's people walking on both sides of the road, and they are filled with speed bumps and potholes and very high traffic roads. And this sister came up to me before service, and she was saying that they pray for me every week. And I certainly appreciate what she said to me, because as I was traveling all those miles in Western Kenya, I was just crying out to God, let people be praying, because at any moment there could have been an accident around the corner. But I'm recovering from my always saddle sores that we got all those miles. But very rewarding, very rewarding. We did four pastor seminars, put all the tenants of the four together, made 500 pastors that we ministered to from four large cities in Western Kenya. I appreciate the goodness of the Lord that, you know, He allowed me to go and took care of me. I was there 2 years ago, and some of you know that 2 years ago I contracted malaria there. I literally almost died. But God was so good, and I went right back to the same place, thinking that that mosquito had died, and all the children as well. And I didn't find him. So hallelujah, feel good. You know, it's our world is every day is just so dangerous. I just started my second leg of the journey. Ended last year. My wife and I celebrated 50 years of being missionaries. And I'm just now starting my second 50. So just keep praying for me. You know, January in Guatemala, Salvador, we were going one night to preach in a church, and we came to a close street, and we were going to make a left turn, and the pastor said, I got to roll down the windows. And I thought, well, that's strange. He says, if I don't roll down the windows, we won't come out of here alive. Because we're right in MS-13 territory, and you must identify yourself, or you will not come out alive. So when you get face-to-face with that, you're thankful that people are praying for you. And then in Mexico, just a couple months ago, the same thing. Danger everywhere in Mexico. There's so many murders happening now in Mexico. It's unbelievable the amount of people are being killed in Mexico because of drugs and all the other related things. There again, you're thankful that people are praying for you. Like I said, I just come out of Kenya. In a month from now, I'm going to the Peruvian jungle. Go to Lima, the capital, fly to Iquitos, which is on the Amazon River, and then take an all night, it's kind of like a freighter, all night long up another branch or tributary of the Amazon River, where we'll be meeting a town called New St. John. And there they'll be coming probably at least 70 churches scattered out throughout the Amazon jungle there that's going to be meeting together for a week. And I'm looking forward for that trip, because it's a great opportunity to share the Word of God. Also, there's a Bible school there. We've been ministering in the Bible school. And so many different people. Last year, there was 2,500 people there. And I believe there's going to be more this year. So I'm just looking forward to this. There again, I would ask your prayers. I did the 28th of July for that trip. And just pray that God will keep all the hungry tigers and the anacondas away, and that they will not have to be hungry to meet the white missionary, okay? But these are realities that you go out to when you go to these places. And then when I come back from that, I'll be going to a place where I lived for 9 years, Chile, South America. So a blessing to be with you. Appreciate the church here, your pastors, the people here. Our sister really doesn't realize how much she encouraged me this morning as she told me that they pray for us every week. You don't realize how that what that means to me. So I invite you, if you don't have me on your prayer list, I appreciate you put it on the prayer list and pray with me. And before I look at the Word of God, I want to call your attention. Maybe you've seen it when you came in. There's a book in the back there. Called Songs in the Night. And on the front cover, there is a man standing behind bars with a huge hunting knife up, and eventually that hunting knife was touching his throat. that was behind those bars with myself. This is a story that happened in 1983 when my wife and two little children were traveling from, after 11 years in Costa Rica, we're on our way to Guatemala. And a drunk man fell in front of my car. I couldn't avoid the accident. And because of that, I was placed in prison for at least a year. But this book is a series of miracles, one miracle after another, because we found ourselves in Mexico not knowing one soul. We didn't have hardly any money. And God began to work in supernatural ways, bringing people together. Then I was set free in 7 days. So I met the story. A pastor friend of mine, the wife, went to Mexico. She interviewed people who was involved there, took pictures, interviewed my wife and I. And it's written in form of a novel. And it's come out about a month ago, although it happened in 1983. It came out about a month ago. And it's amazing the reports we're hearing back from this book. I don't know how many people have been telling me, I picked up the book and I could not let it down to let it all through. Because this woman has done a tremendous job in writing. And the facts are all true because it happened to my wife and myself when we were there. So I put this in the back there. If you're interested in this book, it's $19.99. And you feel free to pick one up as you go out and put the money there. I recommend it to you, not because it's mine, but actually it's a tremendous story of miracle, modern-day miracles that God put together. So I left that for you if you'd like to take one. One little thing that I forgot to mention, while I was on this trip in Africa, the tremendous testimonies of the pastors as we were teaching them God's Word. But over the years, the Lord has used me with word of knowledge to pray for women who are barren. And there are children scattered around because of my praying for them through the word of knowledge to receive children, and they have brought forth children. So when I was in Africa, a pastor came to me where I was there 2 years ago. I preached in his church on a Sunday morning, and he said, "Do you remember praying for a woman that couldn't have children?" And that's 2 years ago, and I do a lot of traveling, a lot of places, but I vaguely remember praying for some people in his church. Well, the pastor said to me, there was one lady there that could not have children. Now she's carrying a new child with her. So praise the Lord for his goodness and power to bring life to the barren woman and all kinds of healings and so forth. So praise God. I want to share with you beginning several portions of scripture, but beginning in 2 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 16, we'll read through chapter 5, verse 4. But, I can't even give a title to this message. I'm not sure. Perhaps if you can put a message, give me the message and the name of the message when I'm done. But something about building your eternal habitation, or you could call it, what does your mansion look like? Give me the name of my sermon after I'm done preaching, okay? But anyway, I want to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, where we see the heart cry of the Apostle Paul. 4:16, "For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish," it's talking about our bodies, "though our bodies are perishing, they're getting older," and that doesn't matter how old you are, if you're only a month old, your body begins the process of growing, developing, and then starts going the other way. So we're not here for that much amount of time. And matter of fact, when I was this trip in Africa, I met a dear daughter of one of the pastors where I preached. The mother. The mother of one of the pastors or the priest. She is 112 years old. And she was just spry as a spring chicken, just hugged me and just rejoicing and praising the Lord. What a beautiful picture, this lady, 112 years old, serving the Lord for all those years in her life. So Paul is saying here, our outward man perishes, which is a part of life, yet the inward man is renewed, and notice the words, day by day. The point is, the new man, or the inward man, our spirit man, is being renewed day by day. Now that's a question I must ask myself. Is that really happening in my life? Is my experience fresh with the Lord every day? Is being renewed all day by day? Or are there a lot of kind of blind spots or just blank spaces in my daily walk with the Lord? So Paul is saying, my inward man is being renewed day by day for a light affliction which is but for a moment. And our brother, dear brother that taught Sunday school was talking about different afflictions. And here what Paul is relating is a whole lifetime. He calls it our light affliction, which is but for a moment. You see, that's he actually has in mind a lifetime. Because life, a lifetime, as our brother was sharing in Sunday school, has many ups and downs, right. Many times that are not the best, and sometimes they're very good times. But he is saying our light affliction, which is but for a moment, what is it doing? What is it doing, those experiences in our lifetime? It says, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. So that's the purpose of all the afflictions and the things that we go through life, good times, bad times, ups and downs, that's working in you and I and exceeding, as he said, eternal, get that word, eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. And sometimes I feel that we're probably, all of us are probably very guilty of just looking at the temporal. Looking at the temporal, the things which are seen. We place our values, our time, our energies on the things which are seen. But he says those are temporal. But he says if we do place our values and strength on that which is not seen, that is eternal. So I must weigh my Christian walk with the Lord. Am I walking for the temporal things, living for the temporal things? Am I walking, am I living for eternal things? Now, I know all of us, we're living in America, although I know some people who've never heard the gospel here in America, I've talked with them. But most of us have been in church many years. We've got radio programs, TV programs about the gospel. So I would say most of us have an idea in our heart that there is an eternity, and after life we'll be going to, some people say heaven, whatever you want to call it, we'll be going to eternity. But the thought is, when we arrive at eternity, there might be some shocks. Not in the sense that we're going to be very unhappy the rest of eternity, but will we be missing out on some of the things that the Lord really wanted to give us during our lifetime? Not temporal things, but to give us spiritual things or eternal things in our lifetime. And so Paul is saying that we should walk our lives in this short time that we have here on earth in the sense that we're going to be walking in heaven right here on earth. Now, I know there's a real heaven. After we die, we'll go to a real heaven. I know there's a real eternity that will never end. But as you look at this, he says, verse 5, chapter 5, verse 1, for we know that of our earthly house, this body of ours, of this tabernacle or dissolve, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. So here Paul is saying we have a building of God which is eternal in the heavens. Now what is that building going to look like? And I think as I look through the scriptures with you this morning, we have a great deal to do with our building. We have a great deal to do with our heavenly home. That we are sending the materials on to glory right now we are living. He says, as he goes on to say, for in this we groan. I want you to notice the language of Paul. We groan earnestly. Notice a groaning earnestly. I mean, it's very heavy on his heart. We groan earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house. He says, I'm groaning that I would be clothed upon with my eternal house. Now, we know in our lifetime, probably most of us do a lot of groaning and hard work and energy to build an earthly house. And there's nothing wrong to have an earthly house. We have to have to eat, we have to sleep, and we have to have clothes to wear. But Paul is saying, I am groaning, and groaning earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is from heaven. So if there is a heavenly house, and he says, that is what my desire is, my heavenly house. He goes on to say, for if so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. So Paul is concerned that he must be clothed upon with his heavenly house. Because he says, if I'm not clothed upon with my heavenly house, I'll be found naked. Now, in terms of the gospel, he's not talking about going to hell. He's not talking about that he would be cast away from God. But he's talking about an inferior dwelling place in heaven. Place of lesser degree than others that are going to be found in heaven. Now, everyone is going to be happy in heaven. I don't want to give you a bad picture this morning that heaven's going to be terrible. It's going to be the most glorious, beautiful, wonderful, happy place that you could ever imagine or think of. But at the same time, some will have greater glory than others. So he says, I am very concerned that I will be clothed upon. And first of all, we know that begins by receiving Jesus Christ as our Savior. So if you're not saved, you're not born again, then you're not even on the journey. But after we're on the journey, by being saved, then Paul is concerned that we would be clothed with our spiritual house and not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle, its present body, do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon that mortality might be swallowed up of life. And so we find here that he is very, very concerned about his spiritual life, that he realizes that he and all of us, whether we like it or not, all of us are building our spiritual house for eternity. Now, I'm going to go to a portion of scripture that you know very, very well, John chapter 14. And these scriptures that I'm going to be reading this morning all have to do with this thought of our eternal house, our building that we're building for the Lord. So John tells the Apostle John tells us what basically is Jesus. It's Jesus speaking to you and I in John chapter 14, beginning of verse 1. He says these words: "Let not your heart be troubled. And, you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house." Now I want to give a few different words to this interpretation. I think it helps us understand better the second verse of John chapter 14, verse 2. When I read it in this way, in my father's family are many mansions. And this, or we would say, in my father's family there are many abiding places. And the word here is mansion, but we must consider what kind of mansion I'm going to have in heaven. What kind of a mansion are you going to have in heaven? Most people have the idea that we're saved, God's got already a big mansion waiting for us, and we're going to be living there happily everlasting. But I think as you look at Scripture, you begin to understand that it's not just like that. There are certain qualifications for our mansions in heaven. So he says, in my Father's family are many abiding places, and if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and that word place should be better translated placement. I go to prepare a placement for you. So God is saying, I have a house. He says, I have a, in my Father's family, just like any of you have families, you have rooms for your children, and there are many abiding places in the Father's family, and he's going to prepare a placement where they will be in that great big house of God. So the question is, where is it? Where is that placement? What does it look like? What does it look like? And what is it made of? What is it made of? So let's look at a couple scriptures along with that to help us understand. Let's go to the book of Song of Solomon. Song of Solomon chapter 8, and for those, I'm probably most of you know about Song of Solomon, beautiful love story typifying the Lord Jesus Christ and the church and the bride of Christ. And so this book of 8 chapters is a dialogue between the bridegroom and the bride. And I want to go to the very last chapter where the whole part, the whole eight chapters is a conversation between the bride and the bridegroom, and they're talking, and a lot's going on. And so now comes the end of the book in verse 8. The bride says, "We have a little sister." Now, in what this is referring to in our terms today, she is the bride, and she's saying, "We have a little sister," or can represent many believers in the Lord, male or female. "We have a little sister, and she has no breasts." Now, you must understand this is poetical language, and it's not talking of real. This little sister of ours has no breasts, or she is not developed. She is immature. She has not followed through much with the Lord, although she's saved as a little sister. But the bride is concerned about the others in the church. The bride is concerned about all the multitude of believers in this world today. And I think if you look at them in the spiritual context of the Word of God, that they're very immature. The Apostle Paul calls them carnal, different ways that they're described. And she says, this little sister of ours is not developed, she's not mature. Then she asks the question, what should we do for our sister in the day when she shall be spoken for? Now, this is a reference to when someone will ask of her hand for marriage, in the natural, but in the spiritual, it's speaking of when you and I meet the Lord. When someone asks for her hand, when the Lord calls her home, she's asking the question, very concerned about the little sister, which represents a multitude of believers that have not allowed God to mature their lives, to develop them, whether they're spiritual, true spiritual men and women. And so she's concerned because, you know, everywhere you go, people believe in the rapture. They believe that after we die, we're going to go to heaven. That's something that's going to happen to every one of us. We're all going to die, and we're all going to, hopefully, if we're saved. If we're not saved, we're not going to heaven. But if we're saved, we're going to heaven.
Right.
But the point is, when that time comes, am I going to be a mature Christian in the Lord? Am I going to be developed in the Lord that in the natural, my husband-to-be will receive me as a full-grown woman in that sense? So that she's very concerned. And then she says in verse 9, if she be a wall, we will build upon her a palace of silver. Now, in this verse, there's two descriptions of the bride. If she be a wall, we will build upon her a palace of silver. If she be a door, we will enclose her with boards of cedar. Then she says in verse 10, I am a wall, and my breasts like towers. In other words, she's fully mature, fully developed, and it recognizes her position in the Lord. I am a wall, my breasts like towers. And then she says, then in his eyes is one that found favor, or shalom, or found peace with her God. Because she was found before the Lord, her bridegroom, fully developed, fully mature in the Lord. So the question is being asked, what about the little sisters? What about the little, put it this way, little brothers as well, that have not fully developed in the Lord? And there's two possibilities that she gives. If she be a wall, and we will build upon her a palace of silver, which speaks of a beautiful dwelling place on the wall. The cities in those days were walled around, and they actually built houses on top of those walls. So she's describing, if our sister is a wall, we will build upon her a palace of silver. So that's a question I have to ask myself. Number one, in the context of this, am I a wall or am I a door? Because there's two of them. Am I a wall or a door? And on a wall, she says, we will build a beautiful palace of silver. The word silver speaks of redemption, fruits of our redemption, fruits of our salvation. And it should be a door, which speaks of going in and coming out. Because all of us in our Christian walk, I think you could probably describe them in that way. If I'm a door, now I consider myself a door because my life is going in, coming out. I'm a door. And so he says, if she be a door, we would close her with boards of cedar. And cedar is a lumber that will not decay. Insects will not eat that wood. It's a very everlasting wood, you might say in that way. If he is a door, or she is a door, we'll enclose her with boards of silk and cedar. So the question is, what am I and what am I doing? What am I? Am I a wall or am I a door? Am I allowing God, if I am a wall, to build on that wall? Because wall speaks of several things. It speaks of protection. You're in the church here, in a sense you're but some of you are walls, that you're supporting the church. You're there as pillars in the house of God. You're there to be decorated by the Lord, which are, as he says, of silver, the works of salvation, the fruits of our repentance unto the Lord. But the point is, the preoccupation of the bride, that what will happen in the hour of death? What will happen in the hour when her name is called for? Will she be mature and ready to meet her bridegroom? Or will be a lot of things lacking? So we must understand what God is saying there. That in this mansion, as Jesus says, in my family are many dwelling places. And I'm going to prepare a placement for you, or a placing for you. So, will I be that wall that's totally developed and mature? Will I be that door that is totally submissive and mature and obedient to the Lord? Now, if we go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning at verse 6, here Paul gives us an idea of what this is talking about. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 6. Because I don't want to be a judge. I don't want to be a critic. I just talk from more than 50 years of experience that I feel that there are many Christians that are very relaxed in their Christian walk. They're very relaxed in what they do for the Lord. And their lives are really in what, if you would compare them with the Apostle Paul, they're really not sincere. They're just fulfilling their religious duty. They go to church on Sunday. But during the week, most of their life is geared to themselves. But you see, when you begin to see the Word of God, and begin to understand the Word of God, you begin to realize that we're here for a purpose. We're here for a purpose. And it's not just to fulfill our fleshly desires and all the things that we desire in this world that we think are temporal. Paul says they are temporal things. They are not eternal things. My heart's concerned, very concerned. That when I say this, I'm not meaning you personally, but the way we live our Christian lives. What is the goal of my Christian life? Why am I here on earth? I'm here. Maybe I might make that age of that lady in Africa, 112. Very doubtful, but we might. But why? What about my life here while I'm living? What am I interested in? What's my love? What's my desire? And Paul's desire was, I'm earnestly desiring. I'm groaning in my spirit that I might be clothed upon with my eternal house. Amen. So Paul was, he was active and he knew why he was here on earth. He says, I don't live. My life, I'm dead in Christ, but I live the life of Jesus by the power of the Holy Ghost working through me. And this is his whole goal, his whole outreach of preparing an eternal house for himself. He calls it there, what we read in 2 Corinthians, and not be found naked. Terrible thing to be found naked before God. Right. But if I have been living for myself, then perhaps I might be found naked before God, and I might be found, instead of being in a mansion, I might be found in a little tiny hut, and maybe not a very nice hut at all. So the question is, am I sending materials? Am I preparing my spiritual house? Am I preparing for my eternity? You know you want a mansion. You know you do. You've heard about it all your life. But am I really going to be found in that mansion? You see, he says there's many places in God's family. It's not just one huge corral where God brings all these sheep together and they're all living happily ever after. It's all divided up, it's all organized by God, and I want to, first of all, I'll be glad if I just make it in. That's the honest truth. And I'll be glad if I make it in. But if I can go beyond that, I want to have a good wealth. I want to have a good welcome in eternity with the Lord Jesus. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul is talking about this, and I'll begin reading in verse 6. Chapter 3, verse 6. I have planted, Paul is a water, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither is he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. And every man shall receive his own reward. Now I want you to listen to these words. Every man shall receive his own reward. I will not receive your reward. You will not receive my reward. It's up between us and God. So everyone, he says, is some planting and some watering. So they're involved in the kingdom of God. They're involved. And so he says, every man's going to receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. You're God's husbandry. You're God's building. You see this? He says, these words, how they're put together, and they go together with these other scriptures that I've been reading to you this morning. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. So this is us, the question to you and I. Paul says, I have laid the foundation. Now he says, we have this foundation. Now be careful, be cautious, be diligent that how you build upon that foundation. How we are building. So I must ask myself the question, how am I building on the foundation of God, which Paul says is Jesus Christ? For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. He's the only foundation. Only foundation. You know, I was very sad when I was in Kenya, because we passed probably hundreds of Seventh-day Adventist churches. Hundreds of them. Very, very strong in Kenya. And I asked the Kenyan pastors a question. How do they stand on salvation? Because I knew a Seventh-day Adventist bishop in Chile when I lived there. He was joined with our pastor's meetings. And he was a man born again. I believe he was born again. Yet he practiced their church on Saturday. And I don't have a problem with that, although it's false doctrine. You study out scripture, it's false doctrine. Now, I've seen signs of churches, Seventh-day Pentecostals, Seventh-day Baptists. I've seen those signs in different places from churches. If you study all of the Bible, it's a wrong doctrine. I'm not here to fight this morning. I just tell you that's what it is. But they were telling me in Kenya, because I asked specifically the question, what is our salvation based upon? Is it based upon the work of the Lord Jesus Christ? Or is it based on them guarding the Saturdays? And they said without a doubt, their way of thinking and looking is that they base everything on the Sabbath, the Sabbath day or the Saturday. And they're not really confiding in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. So that's a question there, because there, I said, in Kenya, multitudes of churches, Seventh-day Adventists. But are they saved? Are they saved? Because there's only one foundation. I don't care who you are. There's only one foundation. I say that on authority, the Word of God, not my own thinking. But the authority of the Word of God tells us, Jesus, I am the way. There's only one way. He says there's only one way between Jesus Christ and God and man, that's the man, Jesus Christ. So that he's the only way. There's no other name under heaven whereby we must be saved. And I'm very dogmatic with that, because we're living in a day, so many people today, well, if we're all sincere, we're going to get to the same place. I'm sorry, you're on the wrong roadmap. You're on the wrong roadmap if you think if you're sincere and you do your way before God, we're all going to go to the same place. That's not true. That's not true. And so he says, for other foundation can no man lay that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. He's the only foundation for our lives. And behooves you and I, if we're not on the right foundation, we better get on the right foundation. Because that's the principal part of any building, its foundation.
Right.
The foundation is bad, it's going to crumble. And so I must continually ask myself, am I on the right foundation? And so we're now on the right foundation, and now we're called to build. As we see in the Song of Solomon, are you a wall? Are you a door? And you will build according to your calling in life. Not meaning that everyone's a preacher, not meaning that everyone's a missionary. But we all have a responsibility before God to live our Christian life. And we're building our spiritual habitation for eternity. Amen. We're building for eternity. And the question I must ask myself, what is my building going to look like? What is my building going to look like? If I'm not sending material, Pastor Sajjad, I think I mentioned this at the pastor's conference down there with the pastors, Brother Fiddlers. I was in Argentina in October. And with the Wichí Indians, and my heart was torn to pieces, and I see the suffering of these Wichí Indians and how they're mistreated by the Argentine government and all kinds of things. And so God put on my heart to build a church there. And so when I come back last October from Argentina, wherever I went, I just mentioned to the churches, if anyone wanted to give. And you know, God's been so good. Since October, and I think it was done by May, $12,000 came in. I just got some pictures from Argentina by email showing me now the bricks are being there, the bricks are being laid. And I was so happy to see that now that church is going to come to pass in a very, very remote area of Argentina. But you see, it was given by churches, by Christians in many parts, and now that's done. Now it's the right thing. That end part is just to finish through the building. Okay, so he says the only foundation we have is Jesus Christ. And he says, be careful how you build. Be careful how you build. And I'm going to ask you, what are you building? What's the emphasis of your building in your life? Now, I'm not against having a nice house. That's not the point. But the point is, some people work a whole lifetime to build a literal house, and nothing wrong. But they neglect the spiritual part, neglecting the spiritual house. And what good is to me if I conquer the whole world, gain the whole world, and my life is laid down, and I haven't built anything for Jesus? I haven't prepared my spiritual house. Yes, I'll be in God's family. In a family, there are many children. But those children turn out differently. So ask yourself, how will I turn out? What will my house be? What will my placement be in eternity? He says, for other my foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Let a man build upon this foundation, and he mentions six materials of building on that foundation of Jesus. Three are eternal and three are temporal. He says gold, silver, and precious stones. And I don't have much time to detail these, but when he's talking about gold, he's talking about the divine nature of Jesus Christ, the divine nature of God, because throughout Scripture, gold speaks of divinity. So he says if you're building gold, you're building the divine nature of God in your life. You're living your Christian life, you're maturing, that wherever people see you in the community, in the village or the store, wherever it is, they're seeing the nature of God, how God walks, how God speaks, how God reacts, etc., etc. He says, if you're building or gold, that's the divine nature of God in your life. So the question I must ask, as I am in my family, as I am in my community, or on the job, or my neighborhood, what are my neighbors seeing? Are they seeing the nature of God, or are they seeing my own nature, my much carnality? Then he says, if you build silver, which silver always speaks of redemption in Scripture. And I have verses of Scripture I can give you to bring them out, but I'll not do that for sake of time. But you see, silver speaks of the fruits of our repentance. our salvation, our redemption, silver. So he says, if you're building silver, or are there fruits of your repentance? In other words, is my life being changed? And I think one of the saddest things that grips my heart is that I see people who confess they are Christians. Well, I'm a Christian. But you don't see hardly any fruits of repentance. Their mouths speak the same things. Their eyes see the same things. There are so many things. It's just the way they were before they were unsaved. They were saved.
Sure.
So the point is, am I building gold, the nature of God in my life? Am I building silver, the works of redemption, the fruits of repentance in my life? And then he says, precious stones, which represents our gifts and our callings. You know, Romans 11:29 says that the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. So God gives everyone a gift. God gives everyone a calling. Am I fulfilling my calling? Am I using my gifts? There's all kinds of gifts that the Bible mentions. Am I being used in these gifts? Am I using these gifts that God has for me? And let's be honest with ourselves. Some people are very active, and other people are not very active. They're sitting on their backsides, and with God the same way. Not much emphasis, not much desire. And they don't realize they are not sending materials ahead for their mansion in eternity. So will my mansion be a mansion, or what might be a little tiny grass hut? I don't know. I'm just crying out to God that I will be there somewhere. But the point is, we have our responsibility to build our house. Build our house. Now he goes on to say, if you build wood. Now wood, if you look at scripture, wood speaks of humanity. So is all my life geared up in human things, human philosophies, human ideas, everything of my human strength. If my whole life, even some people put all in their Christian life, a lot of it is human. So we need to cry out, God, I don't want to be building human things. I want to be to build those of gold. And not literal gold, but of gold and silver and precious stones, which are eternal, which are the nature of God, the works of salvation, and the callings of God. He says that they're hay. Now what does it, where does the hay go? It goes in the stomach of a cow, stomach of a horse. So in my Christian life producing hay, that speaks of our carnality. It speaks of carnality. It says, I'm geared to my belly. I'm not pointing my finger at anyone, but just asking us to analyze our lives this morning. Where is my Christian life going? What is my Christian life about? Is it all about my belly? I remember the parable, the story of the Samaritan woman. Here was a woman who was in need of salvation. Jesus was very tired, came by the well, and the story is that he offered her salvation. She received salvation, and she went back and won her whole town to the Lord, brought them all about to Jesus. But the disciples in that story were all interested in their bellies. They went out because they'd been walking all morning, away break of day. They were in evangelistic crusades. You read the story there in John chapter 4. And when they got to the well, they went to buy some food. And when they came back, they kept begging Jesus, come on, Jesus, eat. And the whole story was about his disciples interested in their own bellies. Jesus says, I've got meat to eat. But you don't know what you're talking about. Give it. My meat is to do the will of my Father. My meat is to do the will of my Father. So I asked yourself, you're not a big preacher. You're not a big missionary. What is your goal in life? How many years ago did you get saved? I don't care if you got saved a year ago, 10 years, 50 years ago. It doesn't matter. What is your goal in life? Because we, whether we like it or not, we're building a house. Right. We're building a spiritual house.
Right.
Because I don't want to be found, in the words of the Apostle Paul, I don't want to be found naked. And I want to be clothed with gold, not literal, but silver and precious stones. So he says if you are building wood, hay that goes into the belly of a cow, or if you're building, he uses the word here, stubble, which is useless. Basically useless. It doesn't value anything. So what am I Christian life all about? Is it of any value? No, I don't. I understand. I am not talking about winning our way into heaven. We are saved by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not of any works which we do. But you see, after I'm saved, God is expecting us to use that salvation.
Right.
So he says, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what soul it is. You see, one day we're going to be met with fire. God's fire will try every part about my life. And the three things that will remain in the fire, after the fire, are the gold, silver, and the precious stones. The wood, hay, and stubble, human carnality, will all be burned up.
Right.
Now, you're not going to go to hell. Let me say this. Any man's work abide, which he hath built thereon, he shall receive a reward. Okay, the question is, what reward? What reward shall I receive? And I think it has a lot to do with what we've seen there. Jesus says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And there's placements. And will we rewarded by what we have done in our lifetime? He says, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Know ye that you're the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. So, hear what God is telling us. One more scripture I want to look at with you on this, and you know this scripture very well. Chapter 7 of Matthew. Chapter 7 of Matthew, where Jesus was talking about building the house upon the rock, upon the sand. And so he says there in chapter 7, verse 24, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them. You see, what sayings was he talking about? Chapter 5, chapter 6, and chapter 7. You study those out, more than 40 different themes Jesus is talking about in those three chapters. And he says, if you hear those 40-some themes and what they mean, and do with them. You see, it's not just enough to sit in church. You got to do them. Forgive me if I sound hard this morning. Forgive me if I sound, maybe even some of you might say, I'm cruel. But I'm trying to help us to understand what our life is all about. Why we are born again. Why did Jesus pay the great price to die on the cross for you and I? For us to say, oh, hallelujah, I'm now saved, and I'm going to have a great big mansion for me. Well, I hope that's right. I believe in some cases it might be a little tough. He says, if you hear what I'm saying and you practice it, you live it in the house, you live it on your job, you live it in the community, it works out in your life, then he says, you're like a man building his house upon a rock. But he follows on, if you hear these things and you don't do them, then you're building your house on the sand. So, what is my house upon? I know Jesus is wrong. But am I obeying his word? Obeying his word, putting it into practice, living it. So this morning, as I leave you with these thoughts, what will my eternal house look like? Where is my eternal house? Well, my eternal house begins the day I get saved. The day I get saved. You know, my father was a lonely one. He had sawmills. And I remember him. He picked out the best cherry, the best oak, and he stored it. Right. And then when my dad died, my granddad died, when his dad died, he bought a piece of the farm. And then he built his house that he'd been storing that lumber for many years. And so that's kind of like you and I. Are we preparing the lumber? Now, in God's case, it's gold. Are we preparing gold, silver, and precious stones for our house? you can answer that, Tony and I can answer that question. Paul says, I don't know if I'm making it. He says, I groan. I earnestly groan. I'm serious about my Christian experience. I'm glad to see all of you here this morning. But may we be serious about our, put the name on the name of religion, our salvation, our experience with Jesus. Be serious about it. Be serious about it. Because it's all going to come back. It's all going to come back. I remember there's a book I read years ago, The Final Conquest. A man who was taken to heaven. He was allowed to talk to the Apostle Paul. He was allowed to talk to great men and women of God in their day. They were used by the Lord. Many people in heaven he talked to. And the sad thing about that book was that some of those great people of God, even though they were even great preachers, some of them, were very negligent about their Christian walk. Their love for the Lord, even though they were priests. And they were placed in heaven, a very far, far away place. They were in heaven. But there were many, there were also many who were right at the front of the very throne of God, the throne of Jesus. The Apostle Paul was one there, right at the very throne. And one of the things the author seen was that many around the throne are missionaries. Missionaries. And I'm not saying missionary is someone extra special. But that's what they see. Many were there. And another group of people there were intercessors. Intercessors. So heaven is all divided out. It's a wonderful place. And these people who were away, you might say, in the back row, very happy. Breaking him because they were heaven.